10th stream in my ongoing effort to make my own web server from scratch, reinventing the wheel and all of that. So I did some research off stream. I was reading a couple different RFCs, which are internet standards, that are all somewhat related to each other and related to the component that I'm working on now, which I've been calling internet message. But now, after reading those RFCs again, I decided to rename it to message headers and to reduce the scope a bit and to make more flexible the class. So my plan for this stream, which will probably be 2 to 3 hours, will be first to explain the research that I did and the decision to rename my class. Then we're going to go right into the coding by renaming the class, revising the class's unit tests to reflect the new understanding I have of the requirements of the class and what I think is a good design for the class based off of reading the RFCs. And then we'll update the code to make our test pass. So let me get right into it. There are three related standards that I was reviewing, and I had the old version of one of the standards, which was this first one, Internet Message Format. In previous streams, I quoted RFC 2822, but it's been obsoleted by a newer one, 5322. That one covers email. Second one I was looking at is HTTP, which is the basis of all the messages that our web server is going to be sending and receiving. And then also, because I know about it from work, is the session initiation protocol, which is used in voice over IP. How are they similar and how are they different? And what are we planning to do to cover them with one class? Which is what I'm getting at. So they all deal with sending messages that are broken into two parts, headers and then a body. They're similar in that the headers are separated from the body by a blank line, and that headers are lines of text that end in a carriage return line feed pair. And there's one header per line, except when a special thing called line folding is allowed, and we'll get into that later. Header names are case insensitive. The HTTP RFC says it explicitly, and for email it was a little bit more indirectly specified, and I found a good Stack Overflow question which addressed that. So header values, which is the on the right side of the colon, like if you have host, colon, and the name of the host would be the header value. They all follow a grammar that depends on the header's name, so there's no one grammar that fits all. Multiple headers of the same name can appear in the same message, but there are special rules for that. So they're either allowed or they're not, depending on the standard and the header name. When they are allowed, they're treated as if there was only one header line, but the values are all combined together. They're concatenated, separated by commas. So in general, there are three categories of rules depending on the standard and the header name. So for a lot of headers, actually for not a lot, but for a few, only one instance of the header is allowed. For example, from in an email, you really can have only one sender of the email. If you have more than one, it's either illegal or it's malformed. A lot of headers allowed to have multiple instances, and they're generally combinable into a single header line by separating the values with commas. For a few specific cases, multiple instances are allowed, but they can't be combined for one reason or another. For example, in HTTP, the set-cookie, you'll have multiple set-cookies if you have multiple cookies in your browser. But in general, they'll each be on their own lines because commas are treated specially for cookies. And that's based off of legacy historical reasons with Netscape, believe it or not. Okay, so header values. Oh, what was I going to say here? I forget. Let me delete that from my notes. All right, so the last way in which these different standards are related is that they all have a body to a message, but the body length is not generally known until the headers are parsed, and sometimes not even then. So the user may need to determine it in some other way. When it is known, it's usually a content-length or content encoding or something like that, or a transfer encoding, where it's really easy to figure out where the end of the body is. But in other things like email, you really don't know what where the end is. It's usually just the end of the message, or it's encapsulated within something else, like a mail transfer protocol where the message is given strict bounds. So I mentioned a few differences, but in general, how are these different standards different? Well, two of the main standards, HTTP and SIP, they place no hard limit on how long a header line can be. However, email sets a line limit to 1,000 characters, but 998 if you don't count the character turn line feed. And that's mostly legacy reasons. HTTP does say that you should set a limit, but they don't set a hard limit. So for line folding in a header, which I'll get to in a bit again, HTTP allows it, but it's sort of deprecated. Email allows it, and SIP allows it for most headers, but not all. And for the body part, in HTTP and SIP, the body is completely opaque. It's just a sequence of octets or bytes. And it's totally up to the headers or the user what the body's encoding is or how it's to be interpreted. For email, it's a bit more strict. It has to be sequence of text lines separated by character turn line feeds. So, given all these similarities and differences, how am I planning to support them with one class? So I decided upon this plan. We're going to check the line lengths for headers only when a line length limit is set, triple L. We're only going to perform line folding if there's that length limit set and we have a header line that goes past that limit. When we're reading a message, we'll allow line unfolding all the time because all the specs are pretty flexible in that regard. And that's to support legacy versions. So if we see an unfolded line, we'll unfold it. For multi-headers, like via or set cookie, we'll have the user specify the strategy to follow in getting or setting the header. Either it's not allowed, we'll combine them together with commas, or we'll separate them out into separate header lines for each value. And finally, we're not even going to parse the message body anymore, which is one reason I'm renaming the class from Internet Message to Message Headers, because we're just going to focus on the headers. We'll stop at the first blank line, let the user figure out how to parse the body. For HTTP, there'll be like a content-length header in general in the message, and that tells the user, in other words, the web server, how many more bytes past the end of the headers to keep reading until you get the body of the message. So let's get right into it. Back to my plan here, or not that plan, this plan here. We're going to go and rename Internet Message to Message Headers, and then we're going to revise the unit test to reflect the new design. Okay, so what I think is going to be the most convenient would be to use VS Code for a bit, because it's got nice convenient keyboard shortcuts for renaming things. And F2 is your friend here. So we're going to highlight Internet Message and hit F2 and rename Internet Message to Message Headers. And let's see, a few places we need to fix. Main.xml, we're going to make the path here Message Headers. And although I haven't established it in my Bitbucket yet, I am going to establish the new name. I'll just deal with that off stream. CMake lists. So we're going to find where internet messages mentioned here. We'll rename it there. I really should put that in my clipboard. Git ignore, same thing. All right. Message headers include the path to the headers. Ain't changes. And so does the name of the header itself. Source, the name of our implementation changes. Test source, the name of our test changes. Still ends in tests. All right, in the outermost CMake list, there's a lot of instances, so I'll highlight that, hit Control Shift L, paste, and it replaces all instances. Same thing in the unit tests. All right, so far so good. That's probably all we need to do in VS Code. Now I'm going to jump over to Visual Studio itself. I kind of prefer that when developing the code once the files are all in place. It also runs CMake for me. Okay, right off the bat, we have some compiler errors because looks like it's because our include paths aren't right. Or maybe because it had to run CMake. Let me build again. Okay, yeah, I couldn't find the include folder, so we'll need to do some renaming here. And actually, what I'm gonna do is Control H, so I can search and replace all in that whole document. 17 occurrences, all right. And we're gonna want to do the same thing in the header for that file. Let me go locate it and go to the header. So, again, Control H. 16 instances, and let's change the guard here. Message headers. All right. And let's search for the word internet. Wherever we see that, we're probably going to run replace something. So it looks like the string internet header or internet message. I can just replace with message. And I'm just scrolling down to see if that's generally true. It looks like it is. So it looks like our header's all clean. Let's search our implementation file. No mention of internet, so we're actually pretty good there. I should also search for this 2822. And I'm going to search in all files in our solution because it might. Oh, it's only in two places. Okay. Because I had the obsolete version of the standard being referenced. We want to use the latest, 5322, in both the name and in the link. So let me copy that and we'll paste it down here. And I think I want to update this header because originally I thought that one RFC kind of specified everything, but this is more just the email part. And we want to mention that it's sort of common between three different standards. So let's say this class represents, okay, this is not really the right thing to say here. This class represents the headers of a message. Let's see, I guess it's generally a message on the internet, which is a common theme amongst, is it better to say among or amongst? I always think of amongst, but then I'm like, I'm not sure. Okay, which is a common theme amongst several internet standards. And we'll list them. So one is email, which is RFC 5322. Web, which is RFC, this one. Oh, I want to, okay. I'll say HTTP and then put web in parentheses. Okay, last standard. We're not going to actually use this standard for the web server. It's more for voice over IP. But I'm going to mention it because there are a lot of parallels. And maybe if we do voice over IP in the future, we'll be able to leverage this class. It's 3261. Okay. Let me grab that header because I think we repeat a little bit in this implementation. Okay, actually this is more specific. That WSP token is mentioned specifically there, so we leave that as it is. Okay, so at this point, everything should build and everything doesn't, but it should once we fix up these things. We should be able to run our tests and they should still pass because we haven't yet updated our requirements. So here's another case where I need to do search replace. Internet message with message headers. All right. And were you still using MSG let's just rename that using the rename tool. We'll call that headers. It's not letting me type. Oh, I had to type it here. All right. And here again. I'm using a more targeted search replace in Visual Studio just so that it doesn't over replace and screw up other things in the code. It's like a built-in refactoring tool. Okay, there's some other fix-ups we have to do. Okay, here I have headers, the name headers used in more than one place. So, yeah, here's where the old class had a headers and a body part, and we really want to reduce it to just the headers. What this method getHeaders did was return the collection. So maybe what we want to do is say getAll, and it returns the whole collection, right? Because it's all within the context of headers. All right. And we want to say something like all headers. Or do we? Headers is the overall class. So what is the collection of all the individual headers? Header collection? Oh, not there. It's here. Header collection. All right. So, all these places we're going to fix it. And probably in these other tests we're going to have to do the same name change. So, here, here, and here. And okay, so we need to rename our method from get headers to get all. Get all. Oops. Get all. Okay. Okay. A couple other places where we need to say get all. Just one place, I guess. So let's run our tests. Our test pass. So all we've really done is rename stuff. And that shows up in Git because we renamed all the files to be the files missing and a new file is added. That's fine. It's just a Git GUI doesn't see that we renamed stuff. But we'll say rename internet message to message headers. Also rename some of the variables and methods accordingly. So if we actually go to git log minus one with stat, not state, it'll actually recognize that we did a rename to two of the files. Actually three, it's just truncating it off because the terminal is not so wide. There are renames for three files, and there are also differences because the rename inside the file. Okay, so that is all good and done with. Let's update our unit tests to reflect the design changes. We'll just go through this sequentially. So this is an example HTTP request message, client request message. So here's the raw, it's no longer a raw message, it's really raw headers, or raw input, really. Actually, maybe we keep it the way it is. Because we could give our headers class the body, it should just stop before it reaches it. So we're getting all the individual headers in the collection. Right, but we're not going to have a get body method anymore. so let's just get rid of the test for it. Okay, HTTP server response message. The same kind of thing. I'm just getting rid of any references to the body. Okay, here we go. We're going to get rid of this body. Header line almost too long. Okay, we'll get to this line length business in a bit. Value missing header. Non-ASCII character in name. Okay, this test is no longer valid, and also the next one, because they're dealing with the body. And the next one. Folded header value. Okay, that's good. I don't think I actually changed anything that would require code changes. I just removed some methods from being tested. So let's go. Oh, I don't know why that's still open. Let's go and remove the methods that have to do with the body. Actually, any reference to body we're going to fix up. This method determines the headers and body of the message. Actually, we do want the parser to determine at least where the body begins, so I'm going to modify this a little bit in a minute. So first, I don't want to get off track too much, so I'm removing the handling of the body at least. So getting it back out, any reference to constructing it from a body based on the headers that have been collected. Yep. Okay, so body's only mentioned in this one place, which I want to keep. And we're not going to store the body anymore. We're not going to do any of this stuff that has to do with the body, because we're just focusing on headers now. Which is actually nice, because this function was getting rather big and we'd have to refactor it, so that actually helps us out a bit. Getting rid of body, we're not going to generate the body anymore. Alright. Pretty sure that nothing will actually break. So that's probably a good enough for a commit where we'll say we're relieving the class from having to worry about the message body. It doesn't carry the message body anymore. Don't carry the body of a message. That's all we have to say, right? Okay, now getting back to where we did mention the body, it is useful for when we're parsing a message that has a body, like the server response here. For in addition to parsing the headers, it would be nice if the class told us that where the body began, because you can envision we're going to use this class message headers to parse the headers part, but we're probably going to use another class or some other code to parse the rest of it, the body. So here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to introduce a second variable called offset or body offset, and we're going to return it as an output parameter to parse raw message. So in addition to checking the headers, in fact, right away, we'll just get it right off of our chest. We're going to say assert. And rather than counting these characters, I'm going to use a variable headers length, or headers dot, not headers, raw headers dot length. Assert that's what we expect, and what it actually is body offset, right? So we're going to have something called raw headers, and that's going to hold just the headers part of the message. So I'm going to duplicate that and call this one raw headers. Take that line off and take these lines off here and say that raw message is the raw headers plus the body. Now this is taking advantage of using the length here, so I don't have to actually count the number of characters here. But whatever the count is, we expect our class to parse that. So this won't compile because we need to introduce this new variable. Like, I like to break up the parameters into one per line if there's more than one. And yeah, size t is a good size. It's a good type to use for sizes and counts. The standard C++ library does it too. We can name it the same thing as what our test names it. I'm going to mark that it's an output parameter. If we ever run this through something like Doxygen to generate documentation, anything we type here in this kind of syntax will be parsed by that document generator, right? So we're going to follow the syntax that Doxygen and what is it called? PyDoc, a couple others follow this. This is where to store the offset into the given raw message where the headers ended and the body, if any, because we don't know if there's actually a body, if any, begins. Oh, hi, Morlaid. Nice to see you again. All right, so we introduce a new parameter for parse raw message. This is in message headers. Need to implement that. And we actually have it. We just aren't returning it. We have it in the form of this offset when we reach the end, I believe. Because we break out if we see a blank line. So all we really need to do to make it pass would be to set the body offset to offset. But I kind of want to make our test fail at first, so I'm going to say body offset 0. I know some of our other tests won't compile because they're also calling parse raw message, even though they don't use the body offset. We still need to provide it. Alternatively, we could make a, which might make more sense, is make an overload of parse raw message that doesn't have a second argument. Let's do that. That'll be a little bit of syntactic sugar. So here's a version of the method that doesn't return a body offset. We'll just say it determines the headers, and it says nothing about the body. Now, it's pretty easy to make an overload. You do something like this. You just have a local variable called body offset, and you just never use it other than to pass it to the other overload. And we can even make it into a tail call like this. Now I just saved the trouble of having to update all my other unit tests that didn't care about the body offset. Now I intended that to fail just because I want to make sure that our test is correct. And we're not in URI anymore. I don't know why I was running those unit tests, and I didn't catch myself on that. I was running the completely wrong unit tests. Okay, so the test I expected to fail did fail, which is the body offset. So I'll put the code like we ri originally intended. It's just to return the offset that we were using. And that should pass. And it doesn't. It got past that test. I forgot to update our unit test. We're still expecting the body to be printed out. And we're not dealing with the body anymore, so we need to get rid of the expectation that the body gets printed out. So that's line 86. So yeah, we don't expect the whole raw message anymore. We only expect the raw headers. Right? And I might even, just to make it even more clear, rename that guy. Let's do that. So where do we have generate raw message in our solution? So three places. And I'm going to update the comment too. This method constructs and returns the raw string headers based on the headers. Yeah, okay. And there we go. And one more here. Okay. Now our tests pass. So let's go check that in. So I renamed message to headers to be very clear that we're only dealing with headers, and we changed the expectation about how much is actually generated. Only the headers are generated. And we're also providing a new overload of parse raw string, I mean message, that gives us the body offset. Because certainly a message that has a body, it'll be useful to know where it begins after we parse the headers up. All right, so let's say that. The principal thing was provide a means of knowing where a message body begins. So we'll say provide an overload of parse raw message that returns an offset value to find the body in the original message parsed. All right. And we already, we also renamed imperative case generate raw message to generate raw headers. Now it only will generate the headers part since the class is no longer concerned with message bodies. And I think that's it. So commit that. So let me go back to my notebook to see what we have next. Right, so let's change the line length check so that it's only done if we set a line length limit, right? So emails are going to have a line length limit. So we're going to introduce a new test to make sure we can make an extremely long line that is not marked as too long by default. And we'll keep these tests and change them slightly to actually set a limit. So let's do this. Headers.setLineLimit. I don't like 998, even though the spec says 998 excluding CRLF. I'll just say 1,000, and we'll just say that includes CRLF, character turn line feed. So we'll do it in both of these places. I'm noticing we missed a spot where MSG was not renamed to headers. So fix that. And just to make sure the default is no longer forbidding long lines, we'll try one where we don't set the line limit, but otherwise the test is exactly the same, and we'll assert that actually does parse correctly. And we're going to assert that we expect to get that value that's, it's not that it's too long anymore. Its value is longer than 1,000 characters. Really, its value for header line longer. I know the name is long, but that's okay. We only use it in a couple places. Right, so we assert that that's what we expect to get if we ask for the header value for that test header name. Okay, we don't have a declaration of set line limit yet. So we're gonna go add that. I like to put stuff like configuration up towards the front. So I'm gonna put it here. And here's the line, new line length, triple L, right? This method sets a limit for the number of characters in any header line. This is the maximum number of characters, including the CRLF, the two character CLF line terminator that should be allowed for a single header line. All right. Let's define that. It's pretty easy. We'll just store in our state and we'll have to define the state. We're going to put it here. And we'll default it to zero. Zero will be a special value, which means that there is no limit. In general, that's what a lot of people do. And I'm going to repeat the description here. All right. Okay, so it's not going to pass at first. Well, actually, it's not going to pass at all because I forgot to rename this one. Header line. Let's say it's over 1,000 characters allowed by default. Really, the 1,000 characters is only significant because the class used to not allow that. Okay, it fails, like I expected it to, because we haven't changed the code. So it's failing here. It's not allowing this when it should by default. So let's change the code here. Here's where the check's done. So we really only want to do the check if line length limit is greater than zero. And if it is, we want to use that value here. But we don't count the character return line feed. Or in other words, we restrict it by two more characters so that the character return line feed is included in the line length limit. Another way we could do this is add two on this side. That might make more sense. I think that's all we need to do. It's the only place where the check is actually made. Alrighty. So in this test, make header line length limit triple L optional and settable or configurable. I think that's all we really need to say about that. What's next? Only perform line folding if line length limit is set. Okay, so I don't know if we have any kind of unit test that covers folding. We had one for unfolding, I think. I'm trying to see where I put that. Okay, folded header value. Really, a better name for this test would be header value unfolding. We want to unfold all the time. That was on the list too, in the third bullet. So that really doesn't change. What is changing is we're going to perform folding if there's a limit set. We don't have a test for that. So let's make one. Fold line that would exceed limit. All right, so it doesn't have to be that elaborate. We can just have a single header just to make it easy. And let's first, before we set it, let's just define it in Let's define what we're going to set the limit to first. Line length limit. We'll set it to something very small, like 10. All right, and then we'll have. Just trying to think. Let's have a couple different examples. Couple exam several different examples of a header value and how we expect it to be folded. So for that we're going to need a structure, test vector. And by the way, if you see that overlay, it's someone was asking me a question in the background, or it was a dog barking or something. So I mute it in those cases. All right. So test vector. And we're going to be looping for all our test vectors. All right. So what do we want in test vector? We want the header value and a vector strings expected folding. So for a length of 10, let's pick hello world. That's longer than 10 characters on its own. And we expect hello and world. Actually, I'm early. I'll ask if there is something I do not know or is new to me yet. Please do ask. No problem with you asking. Okay. I'm just thinking ahead. It's most convenient if we can just match expected folding with the actual output lines. So let's define the actual header name here. I don't know. Something short. X. That's a great header name. So we expect X colon hello. And these aren't expected folding. This is really expected lines. And we're going to be breaking up our test vector into lines. Yeah, this is probably good enough. Let's make another example. So something that's even longer than 20. How long is this one? It's, we have to add 3 to begin with. So 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. So it'll be broken up there. Second line. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 again. So something down to that brace. This is even longer. There's a bug. Hello, world. Aha, thank you for catching that. Indeed. There we go. Much appreciated. Okay, I'm just trying to line these up. So we expect here, this. To be careful here to count this to no more than 10. 7, 8, 9, 10. It'll have to stop there. What I want to kind of test is that we don't want to break it up mid-word. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, ten. Okay, so we don't want to cut it. We're only allowed to cut it on whitespace. So we have to back up. And do that. So it's going to end up in 3 lines. Really, I should provide space for 10. So out to there. Just making a little template for myself. And I fix this up. Just make everything line up there. And let's make one where the first line is. Actually, I'm thinking, what if you can't break it up? Thinking if we can't break it up, it doesn't even set the header at all. That's sort of an extreme case. We can make that simply by doing that. So in the extreme case where there's no way to break it up legally, we just won't put the header in, because it's better to... I'm missing some brackets, aren't I? It's better to not even put the header in if there's no way to do it legally. Did I do that bug again? I'm looking for it. Missing exclamation mark? Yes, indeed. All right. So good. Oh, you know what? I didn't do that right. This doesn't have a brace. There we go. Just looking for all the red squigglies to go away. Okay, so what we do in these cases, put the header in here. It's set. Do I not have a set header? I guess we're introducing set header. Header name. Test vector dot header value. And then const.o raw headers is generate raw headers. And here I'm going to do the same kind of thing that the headers class actually does. Inside parse, we're going to be doing this breaking up lines. It's okay to grab code from the unit under test to make the test, right? Okay. Yeah, okay. Where's the part where I take the substring off? This part, sort of. Okay. This is really the whole line now. Going from offset to just this. Why was it a minus one there? Oh, yeah. Okay. It's really two parts. Oh, and there's no minus two. It's just minus offset. Okay. And each one has to match, and we have to have the correct number of them. So let's put them in a vector. Really just copy this thing. Actual lines. And I don't even have to, well, let's just to keep it clear, I'll keep it. Actual lines pushback line, and then simply assert equal expected lines test vector that expected lines actual lines. All right, so unwittingly I introduced this method, which I thought I already had, but I guess I'm just thinking ahead of what I'm going to have, a set header. Let's put it next to get header. Should be set header. Well, we're setting both the name and the value, so it makes sense, I guess. So set header, two parts. Good one. Hi, not Zane. Welcome back. Header value. Thinking a header. Now I'm like, now the header is everywhere. I kind of want to be done with this class already. Okay, this method, really it's going to add or replace a header with the given name to have the given value. And we'll probably want a clear header eventually. Okay. And this is the value of the header. All right. Should probably make a standalone unit test for that. It's a good idea. Sort of a clean thing to do for every public method to have at least one dedicated test. This is actually pretty easy. We just assign it. Oh, wait a minute. No, it's a vector. Okay, it's not so easy. Again, thinking a header that this is going to be a map instead of a vector eventually. It's not. So we have to do this kind of thing. We're iterating through and looking for it. If we find it, we're just going to replace the value with the new value and return. It's, I'm not going to mutate. We might mutate there. If we get to this point, then we need to append it. Pushback. And oh wait a minute. It's a structure, isn't it? Did I declare it? If I declared a initializing constructor, ooh, I did, so I can use emplaceback. Emplaceback name value. Alright, before I get too far, let me make a dedicated unit test for that near the other one. Get value. Did I have one for just get header? Oh, I kind of get, okay, kind of combined get header with, oh, wait a minute, hold on. Did I not have a dedicated one for get header value? Line almost too long? I didn't. Okay, let's make one for that as well. Near get all. Get all was sort of used up here for these things. All right. Get value of missing header. I didn't have one for just get value of not missing header. Get value of present header. So one that's present host is this. And we'll have one for set. Set header. Actually, we're gonna have two examples. Set header add and set header replace. Header replace. Okay, so set header. We're going to add a new header. X is PogChamp. And we'll just have it regenerate it back out. It's going to be the same thing, but appended to the end is x pogchamp. Now replace, we'll just replace host. I'll just do something lame like that. Doesn't return anything. That simply chopped off the www part. Okay. See how we're doing here. All right, I guess we need to look at that specific test. But okay, I wanted to break. Let's break set header for a second just to test my test. Set header. Easy, we can just return early. Don't even get a compiler warning like we should. And yeah, it broke that test like I wanted, and that's not present, so exactly. Test is working. So what's failing? 258. And which test was it? My little trick for seeing which test, okay. It's the first one. Oh, okay, yeah, it of course it's gonna fail. I didn't actually implement the line folding. So let's do that. So that's here. So now we're going to have to be a little bit tricky. We'll split this first. Really, what we want to do is a two-stage thing. We're going to generate the line, and then we're going to maybe emit the line in pieces. So hope this isn't too expensive. Line buffer, and then we first do that. And then and profit, right? Okay, so let's make it a function. Actually, we'll make this part into a function. It can be a free function, right? So void fold and shift out header line. It's an OStream OS. And we're going to have the line itself. And we're going to want to have the line length limit. How about just abbreviate it to limit? This method breaks up the given line so that each given line into multiple lines as needed to ensure that no output line, given input line into multiple output lines. Actually, I'm gonna do one more thing. Let me terminate that. I'm going to remove the shift out thing because I don't like it doing more than one thing. We'll just say fold header line. And what we'll do is we'll return a vector strings. And I have a plan for handling that case where it's impossible to fold it. I'll get to that in a second. So that breaks up the given line input line to multiple output lines as needed to ensure that no output line is longer than the given line limit, including line terminators. Do I want to pass it, make line terminator generic as well? I think I kind of do. Let's define it. Const or CRLF, really. This is the required line terminator for internet messages. Internet message header lines, really. Then actually we use this in a bunch of places. It might make it a little easier to read. I don't know. Maybe not. What I really want to do is pass it in to the method we're building here. Terminator. Including 9 terminators. Okay. This is line to fold if necessary. Terminator. This is the line. This is the character sequence that separates lines. Limit. This is the maximum number of characters allowed per line, including line terminator. What we return, and it's, yeah, so we're going to return the output lines are returned. And we're going to return an empty vector. This is returned if the line could not be folded into multiple lines. I need to say a little bit about the rules for folding the line. Actually, why don't we just make it a strategy? Maybe I'm making it overcomplicated, but I don't know. It might be a little bit fun. How would we specify a strategy? We'd use functional. And we would say it's a function that returns a bool and takes in... Actually, let's define this separately. Line folding strategy. Strat. A G. And we'll define it up here. Type def. Okay, gonna make multiple lines here. This is the type of function that is used as the strategy to determine where to fold a long line, or where to break a long line into two smaller lines. So it's going to tell us where, so it'll return us a position in a string. The offset in the string where the... it's really not line, it's string. Template. Actually not going to use a template here. I'm going to use a function object. I'd use a template if I wanted to make the type an argument. I really just want to make the strategy an argument, the strategy being a function object. So a little bit of functional programming. The type function, this is the offset in the string where the offset in the string where the string should be divided into is returned. So we need to actually give it the line or the string. This is the string to for which to decide or determine or to break. It's not good English. I not speak good This is the string which we want to which we are considering breaking. There we go. Is that all we need? I think so. Actually, I want one more parameter. Actually, I'm going to call this a string folding strategy. It's going to be a Boolean. Boolean. And it's first part. Because I have... What I'm thinking ahead is we don't want to break our headers on this white space. It's a special white space, right? We only want to do that for the first break we make. So I want a flag that we set to true for the first time we call the strategy, and after that pass false. Although I could always just make that part of the strategy's state. That's going to assume that the strategy's call in order sequence. Let's just do that. It's a little bit simpler. I can actually put that on one line again. All right, so string folding strategy. And we'll call it a line folding strategy, because that's, in the context of this, it's a line. I'm just thinking we might reuse that strategy elsewhere. This is the function to call that will determine where, if anywhere, to break up the input line. Yeah. So the way this works is we will say while, well, it's a do while something. Do break offset. Okay, break offset equals call the line folding strategy on the line, and we're gonna be. I was thinking we want to actually be updating line, or we to track an offset. Let's maybe track an offset, which means I want to put this back into two arguments again. Then we're not mutating the string. Okay, we're going to change the meaning of it a little. This is type function that is used as a strategy to determine where to break a long string. I guess we can just leave that where it is. This is the string which we're considering breaking. This is the offset of the first character in the the string is in two parts, right? There's the part that came before, which we are not going to consider as breaking, or not going to put under consideration because we've already broken it off. Do you have a question? What is auto add in the frequently asked questions, or did I ask an unnecessary question last time? Well, I wouldn't say your question's unnecessary. I did have it in the frequently asked questions, I think, last time. But no biggie. The frequently asked questions, that is not really, I don't really need that yet. It's only if I get a lot of followers, right? And there's a lot of questions. And that's only to help cut down on repeated questions. I don't have a whole lot of questions yet, so it's really not a big deal. So don't worry about it. This is the offset of the first character to consider as what, counting towards where am I going with that sentence? This is the offset into the given string of the part that is under consideration for breaking. This is a string which Okay, yeah, we'll just leave it where it is. The offset string where the string root divided into. Okay. So here we're going to say there's break offset, but there's also offset of current line start. So we're going to ask it to figure out, do we have to break it or not? And I'm going to place a note here because we need to have a special return value for if it can't be broken. The given offset is returned if the string cannot be broken. So basically, if break offset is the current line start, then we return nothing. It's the bailout case. Otherwise, we're gonna form our output lines, right? And we're gonna be returning that output pushback the substring of line from current line start to break offset minus current line start. And then current line start equals break offset. And we're going to do this while and actually I can turn this in. It's better to have a while than to have a do while break offset is less than the length of the line. Line dot length. Okay, so how do we use this? Here's the really cool part, I think. Hopefully it won't look too ugly. So here we're going to put it into a buffer first. Then we are going to do a loop for auto, or we could just say const auto reference. Part in old header line line buffer dot string terminator CRLF. The limit is we only want to do this if the line limit is greater than 0, by the way. So if it's only if line length limit is greater than 0, do we do all this stuff? Otherwise, you're just going to put it in as is. Old header line. Fix my IntelliSense. And here's where we're going to get the strategy. So the strategy, and I want to have a Boolean for this strategy. First part. First part. And we're going to repeat. Hold on. One thing at a time. Yeah, we're going to repeat the argument list. It has to match. And it has to return this. Okay, this isn't matching up. There we go. It's got to return the same kind of value too. So we always return offset. It should compile but not work. We'll fix it. So how do we find? Basically, we have to provide a strategy for finding where to break a line up. And where do we find it? We'll keep scanning and we'll remember where the last whitespace character is that we could break it until we hit the end of the string or the limit, whichever happens first. That's what we'll do. So in addition to that first part, I'll need a last break candidate. And it'll be zero. So if we never find a candidate, we'll return zero. Right? Which means it can't be broken. Otherwise, we will... We're going to have to count, right? So ST zero up to no longer than the length of the string. Oh, actually, offset's a good... Good right, go on right. And this is not a variable here, it's a variable here. It's gonna start at offset. So the length of the string, if the character at that place is it's either a space or it's a tab, right? Then it's a potential white space, but there's a special case if it's the first part. If it's the first part of the string, that first space here, we don't want it to consider a candidate. Else, we can consider it a candidate. Okay, if we get all the way to the end, actually we can do a really quick check, right? Oops. If the length of the string is actually less than our limit, in order to capture that, I have to capture this. If it's less than or equal to the line length limit, then we don't have to break it at all, do we? Oh, wait a minute. Is this including the CRLF? It is. Okay, so we're good. We don't have to break it at all. We can just return the length of the string. So here's where we know we're going to have to try to break it, and we're scanning it from left to right until we... Okay, it's not the length, it's the limit. We only scan the offset plus the limit. And, that's got to... We are starting an offset, so it's length minus offset. So we only allow it to scan up to that number of characters, and we're looking for the last space or tab. I'm just thinking... I stopped and thought maybe I could use the find last of, but I'd have to take a substring of S. This is a little bit more efficient, right? So we're just looping through. Oh, and we also have to do this special thing. For that very first space, we don't want to consider that a candidate for breaking it. So that's a one-shot thing. It starts off at false, and it goes to true, and it stays true for the rest of that whole original line. That does look awful ugly. I think this just needs to be broken out as a separate method. Our strategy didn't work. It didn't break that at that space. So let's see why. I'll put it into the strategy is what I'll do. Is that the only breakpoint I have? Yep. Oh, and I don't have the test suite set up to run. Set. It's what's set as startup project. All right. Oh, didn't even get that far? Interesting. So let's go to the fold line. Let me restrict it just to be that test that's failing. Fold line. G test filter equals fold line. Okay, here's that long line. Oh, the limit zero? Did I forget to set the limit? Oh, I did forget to set the limit. Oh, funny. Do I use that variable anywhere? I don't use it anywhere, so really I can just set it down here. Message.set line length limit. what is it? What did I call it? Line limit. That's why it failed. Hopefully. Okay, now it didn't actually output anything. Let's see why. Okay, so it goes into here. Oh, I see. So it didn't actually push the output line at all. Yeah, we have to do something with that part, right? It's shifted out. And there's another special rule that we need to have the... This is also going to fail because we break the line up at the space. And we have to replace that, whatever, if it might be a tab, we have to replace it with a single character turn space. So instead of just pushing back the line, okay, it's a little complicated because we have to add a character turn line feed. So when we get that substring, not there, but up here, right? We get that substring, we have to add a carriage return, line feed, and then a space for the next line. So let me back that out. Right, so if we have to add, so it's const. So if the part, is there an ends with? No. We get to see if the length is less than the terminator length, and, or basically less than or equal to, I mean, or, but that means this is less than, or the substring at the end, really. So part.length minus that terminator length equals the terminator. Terminator. And it's not equals. So it's going to look at the end of the line. If it's not a terminator, we have to actually add it. And also, if it's not the first, part. So if break offset, if current line start is zero, is not zero, we have to actually add a space. Part equals. Oh, it's at the beginning, really. And push back that part. Okay. And then it's the break offset. I forgot to add one. Is the or should the line folding strategy tell us that? No, we'll say that the line folding strategy is always selecting one character to remove. For this function. Closer, it actually added an extra line for some reason. I wonder why. Oh, is it because it's current line start just less than length, right? Nope. That it added an extra line, an empty line for some reason. Let's see why. All right, that's the first line. Hello, comma, end of line. Fold again, world, end of line. Oh. My test wasn't quite right. There's always an extra line at the end to mark the body. Yeah. Yeah, so I need to sort of add a, at the very end here. That always has to be at the end. Got faster at first vector, but the second one is giving us a problem. Okay, it thought it could break it after the is. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Actually, no, that's not good. It's 12 characters long, right? Not 10. So we're maybe having off by one problem in our strategy. Oh, we do, because it's... we can't go all the way to the line length limit. We have to. We can only go to line length limit minus 2. Because we have to include space for the CRLF. And actually, we have to include more than that if it's not the first part. So let's compute it. So const auto reserved characters is 2 plus... first part. Yeah, 1 if yes, 0 if no. Oh, it split it in that place we reserved. Why did it do that? It shouldn't have allowed that. At all. That's odd. Let's step through that and find out why. All right, so S is hello, X colon space, hello world. Length limit is 10. Oh, was first part, how did first part get to be false? It should, oh, I forgot to initialize it to true. Duh. Okay. That's actually a good test. Now it doesn't want to break it up at all. Let's try to find out why. All right, so three characters. Oh, I had that inverted. Duh. We only want to reserve the space for the second line, second and subsequent lines. Okay, that wasn't it. I'm like seeing unrelated bugs. Two characters are reserved for the first line, so that's the ending character turn line feed. So here it hits that space after X colon. It's the first part, so... it doesn't consider a candidate and it moves on. Last break candidate. Oh, it didn't even find it. It should have found it after that, the hello comma. 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Oh, that is a problem. We, our line limit of 10 is too strict. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. So let's make it 11. This will fit, right? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. No, it has to be 12. Yeah, 12 is our real limit. in order to get these size chunks, right? These are, yeah, I think so. Huh, that's interesting. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Okay, it should have allowed, it should have split it after is. Why not? Okay, I is 1. Seven. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Yeah, what was reserved characters? 2? So it should have gone up to 12? So it should have... 12 minus 2 is 10. Yeah, it should be less than or equal to. It is off by 1. Okay. There we go. So I should probably make some more corner cases. This is actually already a pretty good corner case. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. So, because with 12... That's the longest. It can't be a single character longer than that. Otherwise, it'll cut it here instead. How about the second string, though? So if it broke it there, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Yeah, I want another test case where it can split there instead. Just make it subtly different from the others. And there it will be a little bit more aggressive and split there. And look at the error. All right. Another corner case. How about where it's able to split the first part, but it gets stuck on the second part? So that would be if I smash those all together. It will get stuck. It should get stuck. Getting stuck is indicated by that. Yep. All right. What else can I throw at it? I don't want to get too insane, like the header. Technically, you can have the header name be under the line limit, but I think that's not realistic. You would never have a line limit that's so small that you can't fit all your header names. How about just, I should have one where it doesn't need to split it at all. And that would be something like that. Right? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. And then one exactly the limit. And then let's make one that breaks it. There it can't split it at all. Aha. So this one failed. Why? That one, right? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. Oh, I forgot these commas. That's what's wrong. Alright, yeah. Good. So I'm actually pretty comfortable with it. I don't know if people who are watching actually could grok this code. When you start passing inline lambda functions that are more than a few lines long, it's sort of messy, and so I should probably refactor it. But really, what I was trying, the whole intent here of breaking it into two parts is I wanted this knowledge to be about the rules for how to break up specifically a header line. But I wanted the free function that uses it to be more generic, that it really doesn't know about the rules. The only thing it really that I have hard-coded in here is that if it's not the first line, I mean, if it's not the first part, maybe a better way to say that would be if output is empty. If it's not empty. If it's not the first line that's output, then you have to start it off with a single space. And the other thing that's sort of encoded in here is wherever, if you do break the line up, then where you continue for the next line is you skip one character. So in other words, the break character is eaten. And that we're adding the terminator to every line. So those are the only really real things that are encoded in here. And I could even, if I wanted to, I could pull that part out and this part out as other strategies. But I think that would be getting too insane. I just wanted to show an example of a free function that might work elsewhere where you need to split lines up. In fact, I should even make this generic. It's really split line. It's supposed to be generic. So you give it a line, the line terminator, the line limit, and then a strategy that you call to figure out where to do the splitting. So it doesn't actually have to know the rules about that. You have to split on a white space, and it doesn't need to know the maximum line limit. The folding strategy knows that, and this delegates the decision about where to break the line up to that strategy. I hope that makes sense. This I could clean up a little bit. This is really saying you have to add the line terminator if it wasn't sort of included in the substring that the strategy told you about. Add it if it's missing, in other words. Let me fix the call to that. But let me check that in first, and then maybe we'll do a little bit of refactoring. Okay, this is a separate piece of work that we did without being redundant. It's a separate piece of work we did separately. And then what else? That was getting value of a header. That method existed already, so we were just adding a missing test. Add test for get header. Add test for get header when the header is not missing. We just didn't have a test case for that. Right, and then I added test cases for set header because I wanted those to be sort of dedicated to just that method, which we added, didn't we? Or did I add that in another? Oh, no, we did. We added it right here. Yeah, see, I made the mistake of doing too much before committing. So this part is just add set header method. And has two tests. You can either add a new header or you can replace an existing one. This should be just all the folding that we did. Okay, oh, except for this. This is improve name of test for header header value unfolding. Yep, so the remainder is all the code that went in. Oh, wait a minute. I made a mistake. Okay, so this is an example of where I've made the commit for adding set header, and then I made another commit on top of that, and then I realized, oops, I forgot to include something in a previous commit. So we'll show how to fix that up. So let me first get this one checked in. This is all the code that we needed. Oh, this is slightly different. Let's do that one first. Made a slightly different change where we made a constant for the new line. This guy. We can keep that separate. So this change was make a constant for internet message header line terminators. Okay, now back to this main one. Functional, yes. Yeah, so this is it. So fold header values that are longer than line limit. All right, so here's where we want this diff to go into a previous commit. So what I like to do is run git k. We want that header change to be really go into this commit, right? So what I'm going to do is I'm going to make a commit. And I'll say this should have been included in set header commit, right? Now I'm going to, again, run git k. I'm going to reset the master to here. And say leave working tree. Is it soft or is it mixed? I think it's mixed. Because now that's the wrong one. Wanted to reset. Okay, it was reset hard to here. Now I'll reset mixed to there. So now what's not committed yet is the implementation of set header. And oh, wait a minute. This is in a commit. I need to combine them. So which is squash. So reset here hard. Now we will cherry pick that. Now we will what is it called? It's one of those git commands that I hardly ever use. It's git rebase, I think it is. I really shouldn't have closed that window. I wanted to keep it. Oh well. I get my ref log back. Git branch x and I really want to preserve the history starting ending there. Right. So what we do is we get rebase. Let's make another branch here, Y. I think this is how you do it. Rebase master onto Y. Interactive. Okay, that wasn't it. Let's remove that branch. Set it here. Maybe I don't need the onto. I always get this screwed up, so I have to kind of play around with it until I get it. The good thing about Git is that you don't really lose anything. You could play around with Git commands, and if you, the worst you can do is lose it from here, you can get it back from your ref log. So check out why. And then we get rebase master, I think I master. No, that's not it. Oh, wait a minute. What, it didn't do what I wanted. I need to reset master here. Git checkout. Why? I don't want to move master. Now rebase master. No, okay, that it's the rebase that's moving stuff. Oh, I think I see what I'm doing wrong. Sorry, it's taken a bit of time for me to figure this out again. Create new branch Y. Onto Y. It's one of these commands. That wasn't exactly what I wanted. Git rebase abort. Think what I want is I want to git rebase I y dot dot master. No. That one? Yeah, okay. So what I want to end up with is something like this where it's the two commits that we want to combine together, and we want to say pick that one and then squash or use that commit but meld it into the previous commit, right? And then it'll allow me to combine the two commit messages together. And we can say we just wanted the first commit message. We didn't need the second one. Now, let me resize this a little bit. Just need to find the drag point. Where are you, drag point? There you are. So the previous history was from Y, which is our sort of where we deviated. We added the set header and we added a bunch of unrelated things, and then we said, oops, we wanted that under set header. So now we're rewriting history to say, back from the common ancestor, we have a combined commit in here where we are changing both the CPP file and the header file and the test, by the way. So now we've gotten these back, or the, really these back. It's these three now that we want to, you know, recover to. So that's the easy part. We just one at a time pick them and say cherry pick them. So now we have the history cleaned up. So we added the setHeader method here, which we've pulled in that as well. And then these on top, right? At that point, we don't need any of these. These were just these branches I just created so I can hold on to stuff. So that when I hit what is it, Shift F5, now we're back to a clean history. And you can do this to your heart's content, as long as it hasn't been pushed upstream. So that's the last upstream commit. I don't want to rewrite anything that one or older, but I can rewrite all these ones that came after up until I push it upstream. So yeah, sorry that took me a little bit to figure out the right command and the right commit markers to use, but that Finally got it in the end there. And our tester is still passing. So yeah, let me do a little bit of refactoring what we just did. So I got these three. I think what I'll do is I'll leave these for the next stream. But we actually did this one. Yeah, I'll leave multi-value headers for the next stream. That's what I'll do. And actually, after we've done that, we'll have wrapped up message headers. So that might be a good thing. We can implement that and refactor, and then we'll be done with that component and move on. So let's do some refactoring. This one's a great candidate for refactoring. Really want to do is grab this out and make it, since we're capturing this, we're going to need to make it part of our class, message headers. I need to make it a private method, so put it into our ample here. So properties, we don't have any markers for where the properties end, the methods begin, so we'll make that. And then here's the thing we're refactoring out. And this is returning a size. And this is strategy, really, it's folding strat. It's the header line folding strategy. And it takes we need to create a little bit more state. So yeah, it's a little bit trickier. We could move that temporary into the class, I think. Or should we? Is that smart? Is that a smart thing? Maybe not. I did this in a previous stream, I think, is what I did. I made a function that returns another function, and I made a temporary state on the heap. So we'll do that again. So here's folding, string folding strategy. So the real method is going to return one of those. Get string folding strategy. So every time we call it, it's going to return another one of these guys. Like that. The tricky part is this state. And when we don't need these imples anymore. So you might be tempted to just move it here. Problem is that this at sign is going to capture the address of the variable. This variable's on the stack. The moment we return the function, now we've lost that piece of stack, and now the capture, the function that we've returned, is still capturing an address of something, but that something is no longer existing. So we really need to be able to make something that can last longer. If it's just a bool, what I can just do is make a shared pointer to a bool. Or really, we can just say auto first part is standard make shared bool. True. Instead of capturing by value, now we just capture by reference. And the only thing we need to do special is dereference it. So now what we capture is a shared pointer to something on the heap. So let's make a comment for this. So basically every time you call this function, you'll create a strategy object that you can use once, because this first part is part of the state of that strategy object. This function returns a strategy function object, which can be used once to fold a header line. Why did I call it get string folding strategy? Just get header line folding strategy. It returns a string folding. I need to rename that string splitting strategy, right? just wants to fold a header line. Is returned. I'm going to rename that guy to be string splitting strategy. Yeah, the comments sort of reflect that we're breaking or splitting. Maybe I should use the word break. I use the word break everywhere else. Right, so replace that with that. Just occurred to me that oh yeah, okay. This one is really concerned with lines because it's talking about terminators, and it has this kind of thing in there. Maybe I need to actually encode that as a a line continuator. Let's do that. Terminator continuator. I don't know if that's a word or not, but. We're going to use it for now. Whoops. Blah. This is the string to prepend to each output line after the first. So it could be empty string, which would make it do nothing. Okay. So split line's going to need that extra space. And then here we can just say impl. It's really not get, it's make, right? Get or create make. Make a new header line folding strategy, and then we can get rid of first part, right? Do we need that anywhere else? Nope. So reduce that down to that, and it should still work. All right. Just because I'm in the habit of doing so, make sure there's only one argument per line there. So I think that makes it a little bit readable. We're saying for each header, we're constructing it as one line, and if there is a line limit, then we're going to split the line, and for each part of the line, put the part shifted out into the raw message, and we split the line, which is in the line buffer. Our line terminator's character turn line feed, our continuation sequence is just a space. Our line length limit is that, and then the strategy for determining where we split the line, we make one function object which does that, and then that decides where to split by looking for the last white space character up until we reach that limit, and we reserve some of the characters for the character turn line feed, and if it's not the first line, we have to reserve another character for the continuation. And that strategy is used with the split line. Where is it? Oh, it's a free function, right? So way up here, split line. And that's forming an output sequence from the input or the line. Maybe for consistency, I should call it input. I like that better. So we have a current line start, And while there's still more characters left, we ask the line folding strategy, or it should be line splitting, input splitting strategy, right? To be consistent. We ask the input splitting strategy to take the input and the current line start and to tell us where to break it. And if it tells us a special return, which is basically the same offset as the start, that means it can't break it, and then we bail out. Otherwise, if the output's not empty, so this is the second and subsequent lines, we start with the continuator. Then we add in the substring from the current line start to where the input splitting strategy told us to break it. And then maybe this is where we find a better way to say this, but if part doesn't end with the terminator, add it. Then push it to the output. Then advance past the oh yeah we're yeah the assumption is that the break is a single character that's removed, so we're skipping it. I wonder if I should make that a return value here. Yeah, let's do that. So we'll have another size here. Next line start. And we'll have it tell us what that is. And then we'll use that here. I like that. So now the line strategy also needs to tell us. Oh, wait a minute. It's sort of clunky in that return value is used for one thing and an output parameter is used for another. I'm wondering if we should make them both output parameters and make the return value a Boolean so we don't have to use this special note. Actually, I like that better. So it would be more like this. And then we say if bail, so that's more like other places in the code where a Boolean return value means it's a bail out. Yeah, I like that better. So bool. So this is the break. To make this more specific, we'll say this is start offset and next offset. So start offset is the offset into the given string of the part that is under, is the offset into the given string of the beginning of the part that is under consideration for breaking. And then we're going to re instead of the return value, it's going out to break offset is that. And then next offset is the offset in the string where the first or of the first character after I'm just thinking about how to word this. Really, it's two parts, right? This is the offset of the string. This is the offset in the string where the end of the f no, I can't. Gotta think how to word this right. When the string is broken into two parts, this is the offset in the original string, marking the end of the first part. I think that's maybe a little bit better to say because then I can sort of say the same thing here. When the string is broken into two parts, this is the offset in the original string, marking the beginning of the second part. So that kind of implies that if these two aren't the same, there's going to be the middle, which is destroyed. All right, so return. An indication of whether or not the string can be broken is returned. And if the break and next offset are both at the very end, that means it's the trivial case where, yeah, you break off a part, but the second part is empty. So all the first part is the whole thing, right? So I need to fix up the actual strategy we implemented. This thing. Wait a minute. No, that wasn't it. Oh, wait a minute. It was. It just changed a lot. Oh, wait a minute. I copied the wrong thing. It's this guy I needed. Right, so this was start offset. Because now we have three offsets, so I want to give each one a name. And break offset is there. Do we even need a last break? I can just use break offset instead of last break offset. And then I don't have to do that. I can simply say that next offset goes I plus one up here. Right? Oh, hold on. I deleted some code. Yeah, I needed to keep that start offset around. That's break offset. Break candidate? Break offset. And then if break offset equals start offset, well, then we return false. So we're really going to return break offset's not equal to start offset. And next offset is the break offset plus one. Next offset and break offset are both ignored if we return false anyway. So it doesn't matter if this is meaningless. And in this case, it's both break offset's the length and next offset's also that. And we return true. Okay, I think that's all we need to do. Oh, wait a minute, did I used that new next offset correctly, right? Let's see. We're split line. Next line start. Yes. Okay. Let's make sure it didn't break. Okay, good. It's probably a good time to check in. So we did refactoring. That's all we really need to do for the subject line, because I like to, when I look at the Git log, I like to see commits that just have this for the subject line, and I know really easily where we refactored and where we were actually changing requirements or implementing new code or fixing bugs. So our refactoring was quite significant. So primarily we broke out the strategy, extract out a method to create the function object used to determine how to break up a long header value. Or long header line, really. And then what else did we do? Right, so move continuator. I have no idea again if that's a word or not. Move continuator out of split line method, split line function. Basically, we don't want split line to have any strong ties to internet message. We want to make it reusable. Eventually, I would want to move this out to be in a string utility library. And when I want to reuse it for things like splitting a line at every comma, and the only difference will be the strategy we pass in. Why are we passing in the limit? It's not needed at all, is it? Why did I pass in that limit? There's absolutely no reason to pass it in. That's all encoded into the strategy. I'm glad I saw that before I checked that in. That limit is not needed at all. It's all built into the line folding strategy. Yeah. Exactly. Let's say that. Or was it in there before? It was. So split line doesn't need to know line limit. That is part of the splitting strategy, which is passed in. And by the way, if you guys haven't seen it, in my notebook I have references to design pattern somewhere. Oh, name. So, I'm just looking for it. It's in here somewhere. I think it's a design pattern. I thought it was in here. I thought I had strategy pattern in here. Maybe not. Really no strat. Okay, so strategy pattern, it might be in here under a different name, but it's a design pattern. And I'm kind of embarrassed because it should have been in there. I'll have to add that later because we actually used it in this case. We're using the strategy pattern to make a generic algorithm that doesn't really need to know how to make decisions. It simply invokes them or applies them. Okay, what else do we do? Remove the continuator out. Right. Move determination of next line start from split line to the strategy given to it. Maybe that was it. Let's see. Anything else that we did here? We did some variable renaming. Rename some variables to be a little more clear. Yeah, I guess so. Made, what did we call it? String breaking strategy. Well, also we renamed string folding strategy to string breaking strategy. And don't use past tense, use imperative. Make string breaking strategy return a success fail flag explicitly rather than rely on break offset equals offset or start offset to signal that the strategy failed. Yeah, there we go. All right, so didn't need the second window. So let's go look and see if I can clean this up a little bit more. Okay, maybe this a little bit. Yeah, let's make a little function for that, since it's easy enough. It's a bool. Ends with. And then just going to make it S and E. And put that conditional logic in right there. Instead of if, we just return it. And we rename our principles. So that's the terminator is E, part is S. So this is a little free function. This free function meaning it's not tied to any class. This function determines whether or not one string ends with another. This is the string to check and see if it ends with the other string. This is the string to look for on the end of the first string. And simply return an indication of whether or not blah 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 is returned. And I've said this in other streams. I will leave this function here in the anonymous namespace and probably promote it when I have a home for it. Like I have a string utility library. This would naturally get promoted up to that. For right now, though, we'll just leave it where it is. And either some refactoring, like a stream where I dedicate it to refactoring, or when I need it from a second place, that's probably when I'll promote that guy. So now here we'll use it. If, I really want to do is say part ends with. And you could do that in C# by making an extension method, but I don't. Either you can't do this in C++, or I don't know how. But that's what we really want to say. So the closest we can do is ends with part terminator. I mean, it could sort of, if you looked at the description and read that and be like, okay, that's how it works. I'm just stopping to think if I can think of a better name for that function, though. Actually, I wonder if you can make an extension method. Let me play around with the syntax. Maybe there is a way, because I seem to remember the C++ standard library allowing you to do this. It had something to do with No, I can't remember. Forget it. Maybe revisit. Whoop, what happened? There we go. I'll revisit that later. Just leave it the way it is for now. Check that guy in. So refactor. Extract function to test a string to see if it ends with another string. All right. Just looking for things that we can refactor. This one's a little bit long. All right, parse raw message. This kind of stands out with these magic numbers. Magic number being just a number that's not 0 or 1 or some other obvious number that's just there without a name, what we call a magic number. That kind of stands out as maybe needing to be made into a named constant or a function of some kind. Really, this This is if it's not a visible character, or what they call a vchar. Let's break that out. It'll be near ends with is visible ASCII. Or is invisible. This function determines whether or not the given character is an invisible ASCII character. Control character. E.g. control character, right? Space or control character. This is the character to test. All right. Refactoring. Extract method for testing if a character is a invisible ASCII character. Okay. This maybe? What does that mean again? Oh, this two is the... I really should say... And everywhere where this is a two, it should... That's the length of CRLF. That we should be very specific about. Yeah, two is too magical. One is okay, but two is magical. So we give it a real name. Don't know about that. I guess because because this goes with that. All right. I don't see anything obvious that will gain us much. This is kind of funny. I put that in there because If the message header doesn't have a specific header, then you shouldn't be getting it its value. If you try, it says feels bad, man. It doesn't really matter what we return. All right, raw headers, okay. Just wondering if I should make a name for that. Oh, forgot CRLF down here. I think that's about it. I think that'll be the end of the refactoring for tonight, and we'll kind of bring the stream to a close soon. So let me check that in, and then I'll recap what I did tonight, and be streaming tomorrow since it's not a day job day. It'll be more streaming tomorrow, probably. Not sure when. Still trying to work out a schedule that is sane and sustainable for me. So. This was all minor cleanup. So, okay. Okay, blah, blah, blah. One instance of use CRLF instead of that string. Use CRLF.length instead of 2 in several places. That's basically it. This was, I also moved something around there, but that's really nothing. Okay. Let me build and make sure tests run. And also let me show you, I probably have showed this in previous streams, but if you have multiple test suites, then Ctest, which works with CMake, knows how many test suites you have and how to run them, and it'll run them and give you just a one-line summary. I'll do this if I get a whole lot of test suites and I just want to run them all for sanity checking. If it ever says fail, then you're going to want to run the specific test suite directly to get the nice full printout from Google Test. So let me do a recap. What do we do today? So I explained at the beginning of the stream how the class that I formerly named Internet Message, I renamed it to Message Headers because after reading through specifications for different kinds of internet messages used in different standards, I came to realize that the main concern that's shared in common with all the different standards are the headers. The body of the message really isn't something that's the same for all standards. It's all standard specific. So the class was already heading that way where it was mostly concerned with the headers, so we just renamed it to message headers. And I revised message headers unit test to reflect some new points of understanding after reading the RFCs. And again, the RFCs, I have this all in a notes page for message headers. It's the one for email, the one for web clients and servers, HTTP, and then the one for voice over IP, session initiation protocol. I had written down a bunch of notes about how those standards are similar in respect to headers and how they're different, and then what my plan was to basically support all three of these standards with one class, all of the common parts and any configuration to make it flexible. For example, the line length limit. Some standards have one and the others don't. So after revising the unit test to make sure they were correct, we went and updated the code to get them to pass. And I did everything except for one, right? Because under my notes I had checked the line length, do line unfolding, line folding, allow line unfolding, which was already good, we didn't have to do anything about, and then not parsing the message body, but stopping at the first blank line and letting the user figure out, and that's mostly just telling the user the offset of where the body starts and leaving it at that. The one thing I didn't get to, which I'll wrap up in the next stream, basically it'll wrap up the whole class because it's the only thing missing, is handling cases where you have multiple values for a header. An example for that would be like an email where you have multiple twos, like two different people. And in that case, you would use a strategy of combining them, right? You'd have the different values of two separated by commas. We have to support multiple strategies because for some headers in some standards, it's not allowed at all to have multiple values for a header. In other ones, it's allowed, but you need to separate them into separate lines. And that example, that was set cookie for HTTP. So we'll have different ways to handle multiple values for the same header, and we'll handle it for both getting and setting. And once that's done, we'll wrap up the class and move on. And whenever we're moving on and looking forward, I go back to my plan section. And in the short term, we did this. We worked on message headers. I still need to decide if I want to go back to the URI class and do some more refactoring. URI is something I covered in the first like 7 or 8 streams. And then we're going to work on UTF-8 because we want to be able to support international character sets. Once that's done, I'll be bringing in a legacy component, which is going to be really useful for handling network sending and receiving files, monitoring directories, sub-processes, all that good stuff. We're going to be setting up unit tests for that and refactoring. And I call it legacy code when I bring in code I already wrote or someone else wrote, and getting it to conform with the standards we're setting, which is basically we want to have unit tests for everything, and we want to be refactoring to clean up stuff. Once all that is set, we'll have everything we need to actually build and deploy a live web server. The web server is not going to do much at the start, maybe just serve some static pages. Once that's working, though, we want to make it dynamic. And I had two ideas to do that, which is plugins. So libraries you can plug into the web server to run code in response to a URL request. And we could have the code do anything. Could play a game. It could make random numbers, roll dice, whatever. The other thing is WebSocket, which allows bidirectional communication between web clients and servers. And a demonstration of that might be a simple chat room. If you look up WebSocket, the guys who sort of standardized that talk about its usefulness in things like chat rooms. I think their example that's built into the browser lets you make like a little chat room kind of thing. Anyway, once that's done, I'm going to be trying to tailor these components and web stuff to do two things. Making a Twitch bot, which I just thought would be cool. And my main objective, which is to ditch WordPress and use my web server to as the basis for my own blog system. And beyond that stuff, it's whatever my viewers suggest, or maybe we'll get into something different. I don't know. Still a ways out there, maybe a month or two. So I'll be filling out my retrospective for this session, and before I stream again, I'll be setting up my plan for the next stream. In this notebook, you can see, if you look below, there's a link to it. It's publicly viewable. And I want to thank everybody who's coming by just for a little bit, or lurking, or commenting, or asking questions. It's all good. I'm still new to streaming, but I'm starting to feel like I'm getting the hang of a few aspects of it. But I hope to continue learning from you guys and hopefully giving you something that's useful. Or if not, there's plenty of other stuff out there. Give me feedback, please, if you think there's anything that I can improve on, or anything that you want me to cover. And once again, I want to thank you. I'll be probably streaming tomorrow in Pacific time, probably around noonish, so that'd be like around 3 p.m. Eastern, 8 p.m. UK, I think, or is it 9? Something like that. So hopefully see you then. Have a good day, good night, good evening, good morning, wherever you are. Until next time.